What is good? What is up? It's Jordan or Texans Thoughts, and I'm back with another video. Today we're gonna be breaking down Tim Kelly's 2020 offense. With him staying on David Cooley's staff as offensive coordinator, it's important to review what he did well and what he can still improve on. He wasn't perfect, no rookie offensive coordinator usually is, but he did damn well to mold the offense around Deshaun Watson and the explosive wide receivers we got. That skill set to adjust to his personnel will be key going forward, as the future of the offense is a bit in question right now. So if you enjoyed the video, please do hit that like button, subscribe for more content, and comment down below your thoughts on the video. Now, let's break down the film of Tim Kelly's 2020 offense, because the film don't lie. The first thing that Tim Kelly did to play to Watson's strengths was a heavy emphasis on 5 wide shotgun looks. This allows Watson to read defenses quickly and make easy throws versus advantageous matchups. Hopefully, Kelly staying on the staff plays a big role in changing Deshaun's mind and staying, but most young quarterbacks excel with 5 wide as well, as it simplifies the reads and allows them to get the ball out quickly to nullify a pass rush and avoid sacks. Kelly paired these formations with pre-snap motion to help Watson ID what coverage the defense was in, and also to create space for easy throws. The Jags are in man coverage here as a linebacker follows David Johnson out wide and then back across the formation. With the safeties rotating to help stop the strong side formation, it creates all this open space for Fuller to run an easy slant for 9 yards. Look at Deshaun even pointing them out, knowing that one of these two defenders would have been in this area to make this throw a tighter window, if it wasn't for the motion. Bill O'Brien didn't allow Deshaun to have as much control over the offense at the line of scrimmage, but Kelly did. And when you allow a genius like Deshaun to customize the play calls, good things will happen. You know what else is fun to customize? Jerseys. This video is sponsored by F Custom, the best site to create your own unique designs. They've got basketball, baseball, and of course, dope football jerseys starting at just $24.99. Don't want to spend $100 on a jersey for a Texans player you don't know if Joke Easterby wants to ship off or not?
I know he didn't wear that.
No worries. You can write whatever you want on the front and back and sport your old high school number like me. Worried about the quality you're getting for just $25? Not gonna lie, I was too, but these jerseys are extremely soft and durable at the same time. Who needs silk pillowcases when you've got F Custom jerseys? They act as the perfect gift to treat yourself, your child, nephew, or even if you're trying to impress your wife or girlfriend for Valentine's. She doesn't want flowers or chocolate, she wants F Custom. The link is in the description. Use code TEXANSTHOUGHTS for 10% off and support me by customizing your jerseys now.
I'm just trying to feed me and my family, you know what I'm saying?
If you do purchase a jersey, send me a screenshot on Twitter and I'll hit you with the follow back. Watson took a massive step forward in reading defenses and making it through all of his progressions on a play. First, he checks the quick out, but sees the defender doesn't backpedal at all. Then he looks to the post, but the linebacker was able to get depth for just a split second long enough for Deshaun to feel the pressure and have to escape. But no worry, like I said before, with 5 options out wide, there's more opportunities for Watson to find someone in the open space of a zone. Those zones got continuously torn up, and here Tim Kelly is going to attack behind the linebackers and in front of the safeties. The defensive call is cover 3 and the offense needs 10 yards, so Kelly dials up a concept that puts defenders in a conflict of assignment. He's got 2 curl routes here, and if the linebackers back off, it's an easy dump off. But since the linebackers and safeties creep up and don't notice Cooks before it's too late, Watson has an easy throw for 20 yards. Creating chunk plays was the next beneficial part of Kelly's offense, and he played to Deshaun's strength as a deep ball thrower, even having a career high in yards per attempt at 8.9. You'd think any offensive coordinator can create big plays when they have Will Fuller and Brandin Cooks, right? But Kelly used them much better than Bill O'Brien did in the first 4 weeks. Actually using offensive concepts to scheme them open rather than just rely on their deep speed. The Pats are showing a cover 1 look here, and at the bottom you've got Stephon Gilmore and JC Jackson versus Fuller and Cooks. so it's good on good, right? Now to get our guys an advantage, Kelly calls for a switch release, where the outside wide receiver, Cooks, releases inside, and the inside wide receiver, Fuller, releases outside. This creates a natural pick, so the refs can't call offensive pass interference, and it forces the Pats' cornerbacks to communicate this well and switch it off. Since they don't, and Jackson is a step behind, it creates enough of a window for Watson to thread it through to Cooks. Kelly not only helped Deshaun have a career year, but Cooks had yet another 1,000-yard season, large in part to Kelly creating advantageous situations for him. Here, they're going to motion Cobb across the formation, which gives Cooks an insane amount of field to work with. This is a great way to scheme up one-on-ones, especially when you're given a single high look. They didn't get them often, but when they did, Kelly was ready to be aggressive. My all-time favorite play call of the year was when Kelly finally built off of the RPO we had been showing all season long. If you've been watching my channel for a while, you know what I'm talking about, but for the new guys, I'll explain it. Typically, we'd see the slot wide receiver motion across the formation and be sort of a decoy running out into the flat. The backside wide receiver would run a slant, this wide receiver a go, and the tight end would either block or run into this flat. Smart teams figured it out really quickly because it was a simple concept and the Texans, specifically Bill O'Brien, never expanded on it. Until now, when Kelly unleashed a simple but effective adjustment by faking the motion and then having this wide receiver run a wheel route instead. Now, instead of this cornerback only having to worry about one wide receiver on the go, he's got two, and that creates a conflict of assignment. He hesitates slightly, and that's all it takes to create another window for Deshaun. My second all-time favorite play call of the year was this crazy flea flicker. Deshaun said that Duke was going to keep it if the Lions called a blitz. But as the run was strung out, Deshaun called for it back and boom, magic. I don't expect this to become a staple of our offense, but it speaks to a larger point that I mentioned before where Deshaun and the players have more control and input over this offense. Tim Kelly is no power obsessive monster like Bill O'Brien, and joke used to be. The willingness to let the players control options at the line of scrimmage is huge. While Kelly opened up the downfield passing game, the other way he created explosive plays was getting guys in space, allowing them to gain yak. That way, when teams did give us too high safety looks, we were still able to create big plays. I like this makeshift screens Kelly implemented. Screens that, you know, don't really rely on the offensive line to get out in space, because we've seen how bad that goes sometimes, but rather utilizing our two biggest tight ends to block smaller DBs. Get the ball into your playmaker's hands with space to run. That's the principle of all the young offensive geniuses like McVay, Shanahan, LaFleur, and Kelly understands it too. I thought this was another great play call to get one of those three guys open versus these three defenders. It's utilizing the pick concept we talked about before, and Cooks is going to target this linebacker to try and open up space for either Akins or Duke. Just like in basketball, if you want to get someone open, you have them set a screen for someone else first. And the Lions forget all about the screener in Cooks, creating yet another easy explosive play. So we talked about the positives of Tim Kelly's scheme, but he wasn't perfect. He had his struggles as most rookie OCs do, and my biggest complaint was actually that he didn't use play action a lot. When the Texans did, they were very successful, and it helped create even more big plays. So I hope this is a step in Kelly's development that he can take, because Deshaun and most quarterbacks always improve throwing play action. And one reason why Kelly may have gone away from the play action game is because our run game was, well, it was the worst in the league. And defenses simply wouldn't respect our run game. So if they aren't respecting the run and biting down on play action fakes, you have no advantage created, right? So if that's Kelly's reasoning, then I get it. And it is also a reason for why we had such poor red zone offense, which is my next big issue with Tim Kelly. For all the yards that Watson passed for and Fuller and Cooks accumulated, it didn't end up in points. The Texans were 19th ranked scoring offense and they were 25th in red zone scoring efficiency. It's what really held us back from being an elite offense, and it needs to be a focal point of improvement this offseason. Part of this inefficiency was, again, because we didn't have a very good run game, but look at a team like Buffalo that didn't have a strong run game either, but were a much better red zone scoring offense because of their creative play calls from Brian Daboll. The red zone is where OCs really make their money, and I'm hoping, again, this is just the inexperience speaking, and Kelly will create more concepts to scheme guys open as he develops himself. If he can do that, he's on his way to becoming a really solid offensive coordinator, and hopefully someone that can continue to work with Deshaun and bring the best out of him. Lastly, I've heard a lot of people have concerns with Kelly and the run game, and to be honest, I wouldn't put too much of that on him. It's not his fault. The O-line was poorly coached from Mike Devlin and it regressed, and they really just didn't know the basic fundamentals there. It's not his fault that David Johnson couldn't take a time machine back to 2016. I mean, hell, Kelly barely even ran the ball that much. The Texans were 30th in run play percentage, so Kelly didn't force something that he knew didn't work, which is good. The one fair argument, however, against Kelly in the run game were the types of runs he called. Look at this graphic from Football Outsiders, and it's clear that the Texans were better at running to the outside, and yet we love running it behind our guards. There's no excuse for Kelly there, and hopefully he can simply just take a look at the numbers, man, and reevaluate his game plan, because damn, he did not use David and Duke Johnson properly. But let's reiterate that as a rookie offensive coordinator, he did more good than he did bad, and I'm excited to see him grow as an offensive mind. Alright, that's gonna do it for the video. If you enjoyed, please do hit that like button, subscribe for more content, and comment down below your thoughts on the video. Are you happy that Tim Kelly's staying, or did you want a completely clean house? Shout out to all the Texans Thoughts team members. There are so many of y'all now. It is amazing to see. I really do appreciate your support. And if you want to join the team, check out the link in the description. But anyways, take care, come back for more, and remember, the film don't lie.